Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sarah Vasquez. I'm the Rotary E-Club President of the San Fernando Valley. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce our guest speaker today, Julie Jenkins. She's a member of the Rotary Club of Burbank Sunrise and the past president of that club. She's a polio survivor and a longtime advocate of Rotary's worldwide vaccination efforts. And she's been to India more than once to participate in National Immunization Days. She was also just the second ever video guest speaker in our e-club's history in November of 2011. And that interview was used as the program at another Rotary Club around town, which is when Rotarians in the Valley decided that our e-club was a real Rotary Club, which means we owe all of our success to Julie. Or most of it. This is not her first visit to our club, but it's the first time she's our live speaker. So, Polio Plus Guru, Julie Jenkins, welcome.
Thank you.
Let's give her a hand.
Thank you very much. It's a great introduction because the first thing I tell people is I am a polio survivor, but I am not a polio expert by any means. And to talk to this club about polio is certainly speaking to the converted. I don't think there's a single club that supports it more enthusiastically or strongly in the entire district. So I'm deeply appreciative of that. And what I wanted to talk to you about today, since you all know so much about polio and the fight for eradication, is the most recent event that occurred when the World Health Organization, I won't say declared a state of emergency. To me, it's escalating the state of emergency, I think, as high as it can go at this point in time. As I mentioned, this is on thumb drive, but we're going to, as a friend told me, he knew I was speaking at the E-Club, and he said, but you're such an analog person. And I said, yes, I know. So I'm just going to talk you through the highlights of, and I brought some copies for you. There's a press release for the World Health Organization sent out about how one determines what the if there is a global emergency, what the criteria is, and why polio has been elevated even higher to that level. So, dramatic pause. First of all, the milestones to celebrate. India is polio-free.
Yay!
And Southeast Asia as a region is polio-free. But what I want to talk to you about, this piece of paper I just handed to you, my real glasses broke, and so I hope I can read this. I wanted to walk you through, I don't know how many of you go every Thursday, this is updated on the World Health Organization website, and I just wanted to talk to you about some of the things and how they play into the state of emergency. So if you look at the piece of paper, year to date in 2013, through the end of May, or through the third week in May, there were only 41 cases worldwide. Today there are 84 cases worldwide. And in 2013, we ended up with 400, and, well, it's been upgraded, it's 416, no, it's 417 actually, polio cases reported in the world, and 60% of those were actually exported from the three remaining endemic countries, Afghanistan, Nigeria, and Pakistan. So then if you look down below, it gives you a sense of what's happening. And the big issue for us is, of course, Pakistan. A year ago at this time, there were only 9 cases reported, and they ended the year with 93. Wow. This year, there are already 67 cases reported in Pakistan. Now, Nigeria, last year I had 24 at this time, and right now there are only 3, and that's excellent, excellent news, because the virus gets exported from Nigeria into other parts of Africa. So the fact that it's more contained there is important. This year, Afghanistan is up slightly. Last year it had 2. This year so far it has 4. All of those are from importing the virus from Pakistan. They're not originating in Afghanistan, which again is really good news for actually interrupting the life of the polio virus in Afghanistan. Equatorial Guinea now has 3, and last year it was at 0. Those cases have been crossed the border from Cameroon. that has two this year. Last year it was zero. And all of these are part of the outbreaks from Somalia last year. But Syria is has one this year. Actually, it's only showing one, but the second one was just reported, I think. And last year at this time it had none. But because of the outbreak spreading throughout the Middle East, it had its first polio case in about 17 years. It was either 14 or 17 years. And it ended the year with 35. So to have only one in the first 5 months of this year is really good news again. Ethiopia has one. That's part of the Somalia outbreak. Last year at this time it had none, but it ended the year with nine. Kenya has none this year. Last year it had two, part of the Somalia outbreak. And last year, so far this year, none in Somalia that anybody is aware of. Last year to date it had four, and it ended the year with 194. Mm-hmm. So it's really important to stop the physical transmission of the virus across borders from the endemic countries to the non-endemic countries. And then what you'll also have on the other page is this is part of the update every week. It breaks down. It'll tell you what was reported, when, how, and what they're doing about it, and how they're all linked. Another two other countries have been affected by the virus out of Pakistan. One is Israel. Since February of 2013, they've been finding it throughout water samples throughout the country. But because it's so well vaccinated, and they continue now to vaccinate, they upped it so they were vaccinating every child 9 and under, that there's been no recorded cases of paralysis there. And there has been detected in the water supplies of Egypt. So that's a little bit more concerning because the infrastructure wouldn't be as strong there, especially given all the turmoil going on in the country. So that's what that page is. And again, you can find it on the World Health Organization website every Thursday morning. So the Declaration of Emergency. On May 5th, the World Health Organization declared the international spread of wild polio virus a public health emergency of international concern. There's only been one previous declaration in its history. That was April 25th, 2009, with the H1N1 pandemic. The criteria for a declaration is this a public health emergency of international concern? Is there a significant risk to international transmission of an infectious disease? And we've seen from these reports that yes, absolutely. And will international coordination responding to the risk assist? And it's believed that it will. So why has this come up suddenly? The international spread of polio to date in 2014 constitutes an extraordinary event and a public health risk to other states, for which a coordinated response is essential. The current situation is in stark contrast to the near cessation of international spread of wild polio virus from January 2012 right through to the 2013 low transmission season. And the low transmission season is January through April. May's kind of borderline. June's considered the beginning of the high season for transmission. So all of these cases have occurred before the high season for transmission kicks in. And then this is really important. The committee highlighted to the Director General that if the situation as of today and April 2014 went unchecked, it would result in failure to eradicate one of the world's most serious vaccine-preventable diseases. They've been talking for the last 2 years about being at a tipping point and we could face failure. I don't think anyone has taken it seriously, or not enough people have. And I think this warning sign is about as serious as it can get. So there are 10 countries currently infected by the wild polio virus. They are Afghanistan, Cameroon, Equatorial Guinea, Ethiopia, Israel, Nigeria, Pakistan, Somalia, and Syria. In 2013, as I said, about 60% of the polio cases were the result of the spread across borders. It's essential to take action before the high season for transmission commences in June. The consequence of further international spread are particularly acute, given the large number of polio-free but conflict-torn and fragile states which have severely compromised routine immunization services and are particularly at high risk for infection. That was one of the big issues with Somalia, that there are pockets of it where it was simply too dangerous to send people in. So they would sort of encircle it and then vaccinate people going in and out, but they couldn't get to, I think it was about 500,000 children in the worst infected areas. The first group consists of countries currently exporting the wild poliovirus, and I thought, oh, the three endemic countries. Wrong. Pakistan, Cameroon, and Syria. So those are the highest risk stratifications. And the five recommendations for these are that the head of state or the government should declare the interruption of polio transmission a national public health emergency. Secondly, all residents and long-term visitors receive a dose of OPV or IPV between 4 weeks to 12 months prior to international travel. Unvaccinated urgent travelers, people who just don't have that much advance warning and they need to leave in less than 4 weeks, are still encouraged to get a dose before they go. And Pakistan started putting in vaccination booths at their airports now. Travelers should receive documentation of vaccination in a form specified. And this is all part of the World Health Organization's medical thing. And people say, well, how in the world can they implement it? And they think it can be implemented very, very quickly. And they pointed out that some countries already have experience of this, because one of the things that helped lower the rate of transmission of polio as low as it has been in 2012 is that in 2010, Saudi Arabia declared that nobody could enter Saudi Arabia for Hajj unless they showed proof of vaccination. So there are a lot of countries that already have this set up for that and for similar situations. And these measures are enforced until the criteria have been met, certification of no new exportations in at least 6 months with documentation that the strategies have been implemented for it, or keep them in place for 12 months if they can't document that there's been no exportation. And then the second group are the other seven countries, and the recommendations are essentially the same, except it just says that those undertaking urgent travel are urged to have the vaccine, but it's not a requirement. Any polio-free state that subsequently becomes infected should immediately implement the second tier, and then the committee will convene in 3 months to assess the situation and see how we're doing. So Pakistan, this year, as you'll see from this, 67 of the 84 cases reported are from Pakistan, and seven other cases, so 74 of the 84, are a result of exportation of the virus from Pakistan to other countries. Nearly 80% of Pakistan's polio cases are in FATA, which stands for the Federally Administered Tribal Areas. Now, I may not pronounce this correctly. The Peshawar Valley is considered the main engine of the polio virus alongside North Waziristan, where the largest number of children are being paralyzed. Vaccination has been interrupted since June 2012 by order of the Taliban. And from December of 2012 through April of 2014, 60 polio workers and or security forces protecting polio workers have been killed by order of the Taliban in Pakistan. And it's the major threat to global eradication by 2018. Now, there's a fellow, I don't know how many of you know him or of him, Anil Garg. He's a past district governor of 5240, our neighbors to the west. And both times I've been on NID, he's led the trip. He's led about 14 NID projects. He's going to be the new zone polio plus chair beginning July 1st. And he's in touch with the World Health Organization on a regular basis. So in March, Dr. Chan, the Director General, had been to Pakistan and met with the President and came by very encouraged that, you know, progress was being made but it still obviously is exceedingly critical. And, oh dear, so this is where I finish up with the stuff that's not on here, but if my computer hadn't crashed, would have been on here. So there is cause for hope, and there are several things going on in Pakistan right now. The first is that they've been successfully in implementing better security measures. As an example, up in the Peshawar area, they call it the Peshawar Plan. When they don't pre-announce vaccination drives, because that just warns people to be ready to attack. But then they cordon off large areas and send people in, and they don't allow any motorcycles into those areas at the time, because so many of the assassinations, if you will, are drive-by. And that's been really successful. They've, in 3.5 months, they haven't had any, in that area, they haven't had any polio workers or security force killed. So they're looking at rolling out that plan elsewhere. They've also, through a Rotary Club, just implemented a plan for cell phones to help people. And I thought, wasn't certain what it was for, but another reading, I think from some links you sent me, they're doing that in Iraq as well. And what happens is people, when they go door to door for surveillance, they ask some basic questions, and then they can uplink the information from these cell phones into a server that analyzes all the data. And one of the biggest problems with this is, like, the Peshawar Valley, it's very, very intensely populated. It's under the Fatah control, so is the Taliban issue. But it's a lot of migrating populations. And, you know, that's one of the huge problems in India that's miraculous that they were able to deal with it. But these are all things that will help. Secondly, the State Department on the 16th finally indicated that it was a policy put in place last August, but they announced it to the world that the CIA will no longer use vaccination programs for operational purposes. And the other thing is that there hasn't been any drone activity this entire calendar year. So there was an article in the LA Times in December of 2013, and it talked about the latest drone strike. So far with drones, we've taken out 2 Taliban leaders for the Pakistani Taliban. And now the third person that's in place, nobody expected him to. He left and was based in Afghanistan or living in Afghanistan. But after the second one was killed, the factions within Pakistan couldn't agree on which of their leaders would take over, so this fellow came back in. And from what I understand, he's the most dangerous of all of them. And just in a period, I think, from December to March, the number of people killed went from 22 to 60 within that time. And this fellow, as I understand, he's the same person that Malala ordered the hit on the Pakistani girl. And he really, for some people, I think it's politics hiding behind religion. For this fellow, supposedly it is pure religion, and it's his goal to take down the government of Pakistan. So peace talks have stalled for the moment, but when they resume, an intermediary for the Taliban has said that the eradication of polio, access to the vaccine, will lead the agenda of those talks. And in my mind, anyway, I used to think the Taliban is one big cohesive group. But I think it's important for people to know that the Taliban has actually been supportive of the eradication in Afghanistan. And going back a few years, a polio worker would have to have 2 letters to go to village and do the vaccination. One would be from the local government, and the other would be from the Taliban. And I read something earlier in the year where the man who's considered the father of the Afghani Taliban is now coming out and being one of the most vocal supporters of the vaccine. And so it's my personal hope that because of that attitude from the Afghani Taliban, it will help temper the position that the Pakistani Taliban is taking. But one thing I just wanted to do, and it's little, we hear numbers, we hear rarely names, but this is the face. This 22-year-old boy was a volunteer, and he was one of the ones killed in January. So for me, it always makes me cry, but it's just the courage of these people. And they go out knowing they're putting their lives on the line. And they do it because it's important. It's important for their children. It's important for the children of Pakistan, but it's important for the world. And as Rotarians, it's our job to increase awareness and to raise money. So I think for me, I don't have that kind of courage. So this is what I can do. That's it. I think, and I'm not certain, I think it may have been part of the exportation out of Nigeria. That was my understanding at the time, but I couldn't swear to it. Yeah. Well, I mean, it's just in an area. Part of the issue in the past has been, and that's why with the polio endgame for, you know, $4.5 billion to see, or $5.5 billion to see this through, from lack of funds. In 2012, I thought, oh, we hit that first Bill Gates thing, and I thought polio eradication was funded, and I was so excited about that. And I went to India in February, and it was, no, they were already $900 million short for that year and what they wanted to do. So what happens is all these supplementary immunization campaigns and a lot of these African nations, there was just no funding for them, and they didn't happen. And then when, you know, the virus gets exported, there's nothing to stop it. That's why this disease is so dangerous that a single case is considered evidence of an epidemic. So when you go into an area like that with insufficient infrastructure, immunizations haven't happened in years, certain members of the population being left out because too poor. I talked to a fellow who had been on NID in India, and he was working in Delhi with Rotarians. And at one point, they're walking down the street, and they said, okay, we're done. And he could see something down there, and he said, well, what's down there? Oh, we're not going there. And he said, well, what's down there? Well, never mind, we're not going there. And he said, I'm going there, you know, and he did. And, you know, he and his partner have created now a school to help those people. But there are a lot of people that are just underserved. There are people that people want to get to and can't, and it's very dangerous.
So how many times did you go to India?
Only, well, only for NID, only twice.
Twice?
Yeah.
How was that?
Extraordinary.
Yeah.
Just the most amazing, amazing, amazing experience. And for me, if you haven't been, what I loved about it is the way Anil puts his trips together. You're out. The Uttar Pradesh, the state of Uttar Pradesh, is considered sort of one of two engines for polio in India. And we go out there and stay in really, well, one time it was in a really small town, and the other it was in a university city, but then we go out to smaller towns. And you go into an area that, lovely homes, you know, even then, lovely homes, but it's still the open sewage going through. And then on the other side of the wall, it's the migrant workers that, if they're lucky, they have scraps of cloth to create a tent of some sort. And we were there, and that was fascinating to me. They had a fellow who was an informer. And his job was just to help the World Health Organization workers and the local health workers track, you know, who was in that little area and who was having babies and stuff, and to get them vaccinated. But this young woman came to speak to us, and I don't know how old she was. She looked like she was maybe 20 or 21, and had three little kids. Mm-hmm. And she didn't speak English, but there was translations for her. And she was so pleased because she'd learned how to wash her hands properly and was teaching her children to wash their hands properly. And you're thinking, oh my goodness, it seems like such a basic thing and how wonderful. But then I'm looking around this area and going, what water is she using to wash her hands? You know, it's the lack of what's left, that little 2% that's left is, you know, reaching the hardest to get and most underserved population in the world. And so it's a big challenge. And I forget the fellow's name. They were talked about somebody who, was it the smallpox thing? Or there was something that he helped deal with. And he suggested that at this point in time, there's just no point and continuing with the eradication of polio. And I heard that Bill Gates even thought that it was perhaps too dangerous when all the attacks were going on in January and February, and his wasn't, it's not worth it. His was, how can we ask people to endanger their lives doing that? Mm-hmm. But these people are volunteering because it's that important.
I heard, I had one ear on the television and one on brushing my teeth in the morning one morning, and I thought I heard, overheard something to the effect that there was two polio-like cases in our town. Polio-like symptoms, I don't know.
Yes.
There's been something, mostly in Northern California, and there's a virus that's been circulating for a while. And I looked it up online, and I don't remember all the details, but polio is part of a family, and this is related to that family, but it's not directly the polio virus, as far as I know.
Yeah.
I part of me, and it's like, knock on wood, it's just thinking of the mutating virus if it isn't done.
Yeah.
Oh, and that's another thing to celebrate. There's been no case of polio 3 in 18 months.
Oh.
So we're really fighting polio 1.
Great.